What is it with some people? Isn't it enough to know that moss is soft and rock is hard and water is wet?
وبعد ذلك,
after that, why not just kick back and enjoy the view? But from earliest recorded history, there have been those folks who just can't stop themselves. Why is this rock harder than that rock? What exactly is the difference between this thing and that thing or that? Complicated questions, but questions which have never prevented people from looking for very simple answers. On Earth, there are only four basic elements.
اليابسة,
Earth, air,
الهواء,
fire,
النار,
and water. Every other material or substance is made up of some combination of these four. Now, that's a nice, simple explanation for all substances, natural and man-made. It was first proposed, we're led to believe, more than 2,000 years ago by a learned Greek with the name of Empedocles. Other philosophers, such as Aristotle, proposed qualities of these four elements that might change in order to create new substances. In one form or another, this simple idea about four earthly elements was accepted for nearly 2,000 years. As it happens, we now know that things are a little bit more complicated. But amazingly, not a lot more complicated. 150 years ago, there were few more than 50 known elements. Today, we know that only 92 separate elements combine together to make up all known substances in nature.
A second useful idea about the nature of substances
sprang up about the same time as the notion of elements. Take a piece of material, a rock, or a lump of wood, break it apart into smaller and smaller pieces. What will be the smallest piece of it? Atomos, the ancient Greek word for indivisible, was used to describe the tiniest possible lump of a substance, something far too small to see. We know very little about the ancient Greek Leucippus of Miletus, except that he dreamed up the atom, a particle of matter which can be no further subdivided. What shape might atoms be? All possible shapes? Or something more pleasingly regular? Ideas depend in part on what you imagine might lie in between these indivisible atoms. The Greek atomist Democritus proposed that everything was divided up into atoms and the void, nothingness. Presumably, if there was room between atoms, then it was filled by emptiness. This void was a very early guess about our universe that turned out to be remarkably accurate. But many Greek scientists were uncomfortable with the idea of nothingness. Some preferred to believe that you could subdivide matter forever between larger particles. Will be found smaller particles, like sand filling up the space between rocks. On the other hand, Aristotle suggested that air fill any space between atoms. Since air itself is one of the four earthly elements, this seemed a little illogical. What then might fill the spaces between atoms of air? The great philosopher and scientist Plato preferred to imagine geometry as a way of filling all space. Air atoms are octahedrons.
ذرات النار هي رباعية السطوح.
Water particles are icosahedrons,
and earth particles are cubes.
These platonic solids,
as they are known, can be colored.
White, black, and red. A scheme for the colors of the four earthly elements invented by another philosopher. These platonic solids can all be formed from only two triangle shapes. Plato imagined these triangles to be the most fundamental particles of matter, filling space and recombining to create the different substances found on Earth. Over the last two millennia, flights of fantasy by ancient Greek philosophers became carved in stone as laws of the universe. In the Western world, these laws were God's laws. For many centuries, it was heresy to suggest that there might be other elements than Empedocles IV, just as it was heresy to claim that the sun did not circle the earth. New science was not just discouraged, its practitioners were persecuted. From the 17th century onwards, there was a steady decline in religious interference with scientific study. In this new scientific era, investigation and experimentation began to identify a fairly small set of elements, none of them proposed by Empedocles, that indeed did recombine to form all the substances on Earth. As well, new and more useful models began to emerge that described the tiniest particles of these substances and the ways in which they combine together. Early ideas about the basic nature of matter were abstract. We might be able to see or feel air, water, earth, and fire. But it was left entirely up to the imagination how these supposedly basic ingredients might be divided up or recombined into everything in the world around us. The science of chemistry evolved slowly. It took a very long time to replace vague early ideas about the nature of matter with repeatable observation based on careful experimentation. But the first practical chemists were practicing alchemy long before the modern era of scientific enlightenment. Alchemy is a word that conjures up ideas of trickery and magic to produce fake results from the eyebrows of a newt combined with the warts of a frog and the tears of a bat. But step forward a moment to consider some of the goals of modern chemistry. A drug company refines basic materials into pure chemicals, which are combined into pills, popped into mouths, producing customer satisfaction, releasing quantities of cash back to the drug company, which, as we all know, can be used to buy that classic standard of wealth, gold. Throughout the first two millennia, an honest alchemist differed from many modern chemists only by a noble, if unsuccessful, attempt to cut out any middleman and convert other substances directly into gold. Paying the necessary lip service to Aristotle's basic elements, the alchemists nevertheless focused on other substances, particularly metals, with the hope of learning how one might be changed into another. One theory held that the metals were a hierarchy of substances which matured in the earth and gradually changed from one kind to another. There were base or dirty metals, such as lead, associated with Saturn, and the last day of the week, Saturday.
The base metal tin was associated with
Jupiter.
And Thursday.
Oh yes,
there were still many ideas about substances that were not founded on observation and experimentation.
But
in their attempts to promote the conversion of base metals, alchemists actively tested how metals and other substances reacted when combined together. The foundation of chemistry was thus laid down in the Middle Ages. A major driving force was the transmutation of base metals into silver and gold, the noble metals, clean and highly valued. With the dawn of a more permissive age in the 17th century, further observation and experimentation built upon the investigations of alchemy. One by one, elementary substances were recognized that stubbornly resisted attempts to further purify them. And then, in the early 19th century, the world was offered the first modern atomic theory.